If there's blossom in the foreground and an oriental temple in the background, then it must be springtime in Japan, and it is. It must also be the beginning of a new series of Database, and it's that too. Welcome. If you haven't caught the show before, welcome to ITV's Information Technology programme. Required viewing, if you like, if you happen to own a home micro or are just generally interested in the future of computers and computing. Now, I'll be telling you why we're in Japan in just a moment's time, but first, let's look to the end of the programme. At the end of each programme in this series, we're going to be transmitting some data of particular interest to owners of home micros. Now, the data will be particular for a certain micro each week. This week, it's the BBC machine. So if you want to record that data, stand by with a cassette recorder or just make a video copy of the programme. But back to Japan. Unlike all good tourists, the first thing to do is to go shopping. I don't know whether they have any Sunday trading laws in Japan, but if they do, they hardly seem to enforce them, because this is a typical Sunday afternoon in Tokyo, and as you can see, everything is going full blast. And as you can well imagine, being Japan, most of the activity here is centered on selling electric and electronic goods in this sort of form, street market form. In fact, this is the equivalent of those shops and stores we used to have in Britain back in the 50s and 60s, the sort of place where you might buy old radio valves or defunct radio chassis. Well, you can still buy all those things, as well as the latest state-of-the-art televisions and cassette recorders, but you can buy some other rather important things as well. You see, what's unusual about this particular arcade, street market, call it what you will, is that apart from being an Aladdin's cave for the amateur radio enthusiast, it's a treasure trove for the chap who wants to build his own computer, because here you can buy absolutely everything, from a chip to a motherboard. Let me put it to the test. Do you have the Z80A central processing unit chip? That one there. Yeah, just the one. How much is that?
680
yen. There's 1,000, thank you very much. Now, there are about 300 odd yen to the pound. So for £2, I have bought the central processing chip off the shelf for the Sinclair computer. But it's actually made by the Japanese Sharp Corporation. Now, it's going to go into its little plastic packet and the sale will be concluded in just a second. There we are, thank you very much indeed. Receipt, central processing chip, and change. No one's asked me where I'm from. For all this nice lady and gentleman know, I could be a Russian spy exporting that bit of hardware to do something devious with it. And indeed, there have been reports that members of the Afghanistan resistance have been here to buy this kind of hardware to do exactly that with it. It makes a bit of a nonsense, doesn't it, of the decision not to sell Sinclair computers in the duty-free lounge at Heathrow in case they get into the wrong hands, because for all we know, this may have already got into the wrong hands. Now, of course, if you don't happen to have the requisite skill with the soldering iron to build your own computer, you could always ask someone to build it for you, in which case you might end up with something like this, which, for some odd reason, bears an uncanny resemblance to the Apple II and actually does the same sort of job. The man who made this is Pete Perkins. Pete, it looks like it, it does the same job, you've copied it.
No.
What's the difference?
The big difference between a copy and a compatible machine is its looks.
Now, that's going to take a bit of absorbing. Let's go back to what's inside then without getting too technical. This is your board for your Pete Perkins Apple machine.
Right.
Right? If we had the Apple board here, would we see differences?
You'd see a lot of differences, especially in this area here, as well as in the ROMs alone. In this chip, we have a saying about this. It's whatever your mind can conceive and your heart can believe, then you can achieve. That's the purpose of this chip. With this extra slot here, an individual can take this board and do practically anything he wants with it. Send telexes, run monitors, network, anything. You can't do that with a regular board.
It seems to me that you've taken the board and done pretty well what you wanted to do with it. Is it illegal what you're doing?
I don't know.
What do you mean you don't know?
Well, I haven't got caught at it yet.
I see. And you're doing the same thing with the IBM PC, yes?
This is a compatible computer. It does not in any way resemble the IBM PC. It has more capabilities than the IBM PC. It has 64K on, 128K on board. The PC only has 64K on board.
So you're actually claiming that your compatible non-copies are actually better than the originals?
Well, if it weren't, then we wouldn't have any reason to do it.
Unless, of course, price. Now, how much does your Apple-type computer sell for?
Probably about half the original.
Are Apple happy about this?
I wouldn't be.
Of course, if you don't want something that's just merely compatible, but something with a recognizable brand name, then you come to a regular store like this one. Very typical of a Japanese computer store. It's on 6 floors. The top floor is actually a small computer school, so you can not only buy the piece of equipment, but they'll teach you how to use it. British high street retailers, please take note. However, there is one enormous difference between what happens here and what happens in Britain. We've scoured this and the other shops all day, and we haven't found one name that we recognize as being European or even American. All this machinery here is Japanese, including the very latest generation of MSX home computers, which we'll be telling you about next week, which pose a very big threat indeed to European and American computer manufacturers.